Hello and welcome to coverage of Grand Prix Dallas-Fort Worth. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth. William Huey Jensen. Round 12 is underway. Corey Burkhart, 11-0. Zach Voss, 11-0. I'm going to go ahead and say that these are our last two undefeated players, though I don't have factual confirmation of that.
You're the Donald Trump of the booth.
I'm out. I'm just out there on a limb. Don't call me that. Anything but that. Zach Voss on one side of the table here. He's playing Titan Shift. As in Scape Shift?
Yeah, there's one.
Okay. On the other side of the table, Corey Burkhart. Oh, running it up with Grixis Control. Pretty ideal start here for Zach with the Search for Tomorrow into the Farseek, though Corey Burkhart does have something to say about that, as he's got a decent start going himself. Turn two, Ancestral Vision hits Suspend, and he's got a Spell Snare to snap off the Farseek. Now, the name of the game with this Titan Shift deck is lands, right? Just how many lands can Zach Voss get onto the battlefield?
Corey's going to be happy to just cast Spell Snare in game one, at least, when he still has it in his deck, on anything it can target.
These are, in fact, the last two undefeated players, by the way. The limb held up.
Yeah, good for you. 11.
I don't know if it was worth it.
11 wins is a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, now, at this point, I mean, these players are already starting to think of top eight, right? Like,
I would be.
You're looking down the line like, hey, I
only have four more matches. I only have to win two of them.
Now, this was a 2016-player field
that we have here.
Yeah, big turnout down here in Dallas. So you are going to need a pretty strong record to make it into the top eight. You're not going to sneak in there with an X and 3 record at this one, I'll tell you that. Uh-oh, this can't be good news for Corey Burkhart. He's got a Primeval Titan with just four lands out, thanks to the Simphium Spirit Guide. Oof.
Yep.
Wow, and how brutal is that for Burkhart as well, who's sitting there with a land and a Cryptic Command in his hand and thought, oh, I'll have plenty of time. Even if he's got the Spirit Guide, I can still counter it. But how about two of them? This is a major blow for Corey Burkhart. He's going to need to find a Terminate. He's got a Terminate right now.
Yeah, but the damage is partially done.
Yes.
Two lands. You know what? I mean, it's not the end of the world, though, from Corey's perspective. It costs two Spirit Guides to get two lands into play, so it's not like...
It's the old three-for-one.
It ramped. Well, it's not a three-for-one because...
You're giving him credit for the lands?
I'm giving him credit for the lands. So he's playing a deck based around Valakut. He got one, so it's even-ish.
Yeah. But not the end of the world.
Not the end of the world.
Okay.
I mean, it's not good for Corey, but Corey needs pressure, and he found some there.
There's a Chalice of the Void in hand for Zach Voss, which is quite effective against Corey. Oh, there's also a Summoner's Pact, which Corey is going to very likely let resolve, and then he's just going to Cryptic the ever-loving heck out of this Primeval Titan. Well, he's going to let him think about it for a minute. He's probably just thinking about the second mode at this point, because there's no way he's letting that Primeval Titan resolve.
What would he do other than draw a card?
I've never done anything other than draw a card, so I wouldn't
know. Sometimes bounce a Snapcaster Mage.
So you can draw more cards?
Yeah.
I like that. All right, so he keeps that one off the table. And since the pact resolved, Zach is on the hook to pay for that as well on his next upkeep. So that was a pretty nice sequence there for Corey as well, though we see Zach creeping up on land count here, and he's up to seven. He has a basic forest in play, though. So that Valakut's still not active. Ooh, buddy. Looks like he hadn't drawn that card yet, so he does get to take that Ancestral Vision counter off. He's going to mill two Serum Visions with his Thought Scour and draw a card. Let's see what it was, though. Looks like a Kolaghan's Command's the only thing that he's got for three. So So he says, whatever that last card is in your hand, you don't get it anymore. And it turns out it was a chalice. And Tassiger's going to come down
really
as
quick.
Well.
Do you think Zach will pay for the pact?
I think
he will.
I do.
Yeah, I do too.
He looks very comfortable. He put a little thing on top of his library
to remind
him.
I have no reason
to
believe he won't. But yeah. I do like to speculate on things like that.
Yeah, it is fun. The fact that he has that little whatever that is on top of his library, you know, ups his percentage by like 15.
Oh, I didn't see that. Yeah. For sure he'll pay. Do you think, I don't know for sure, is it legal to do like, if you're Corey, go, hey, what's that, and knock the thing onto the floor?
Wow, that is an ethical gray area.
You think so? Because it's not a magic card. It's
not
like, you know,
at all.
You're not messing with the game state. You're just simply subtly removing a reminder. Not so subtly.
Feels pretty wrong.
I think it's definitely
at face value.
I think it's wrong, but I'm asking.
I love
if it's against
the discussion,
the rules.
Though. No,
yeah.
I understand. Yeah. How about this? I wouldn't do it.
I wouldn't do it either. But clearly, I've thought about it.
You have thought about it. Oh man. Huey's bringing the philosophical discussions to the table today.
What else are we gonna do?
Well, we're going to watch Corey Burkhart draw four cards this turn thanks to Ancestral Vision finally resolving. He's even put another one on the stack and gets to crack in there. And this is a simple game now. It's how many lands can Zach Voss get going so that those Valakuts can start throwing six damage around every time he gets a mountain.
He's in a spot right now, though, where I think he probably is still going to need to remove Tassiger first.
Now, that's brutal. Corey's going to get to activate Tassiger on the way out. And, in fact, I believe he's just got another copy of it in his hand anyway.
Right.
This is pretty easy, though. He lets him have the vision, I'm assuming.
No, or Spell Snare is not great either. It only stops Farseek and Sigur Tribe Elder. But those are good cards here. I mean,
yeah, those are the things
they do six
need.
Damage. Yep. So I think Ancestral Vision is probably the choice.
Now, there's another interesting one. He got another Kolaghan's Command.
It looks like
not
he
a
must
lot
have
of instants
done,
in Zach's
he must have,
deck.
Oh, he hasn't done it yet. Mm-hmm. I was going to say he must have done six to Corey, but I forgot that the Farseek wasn't what was going to trigger the Valakut. It was the Windswept Heath, so he just hasn't done it yet. He did let Corey untap, giving Corey the option to use Tassiger again.
He did. I would not leave that opening just in case Corey's on nothing, but it turns out that's not the case. So Tassiger, replacement Tassiger is going to appear. And this is really important. I mean, if this is a situation where Corey was sitting with a bunch of reactive cards in hand, he could find himself in a very tough spot because almost every card in Zach's deck represents six damage or more.
Yeah.
But a Tassiger plus like a lightning bolt applying pressure is a big deal because Zach's all the way down to 10.
There are only a few dead draws in Zach's deck, like his basic forest, another Valakut's not the best, although it's not the worst.
Chalice
through
is terrible.
Through the Breach, Chalice, Anger the Gods.
Yeah.
Simeon Spirit Guide.
Yeah. Now, the problem that he faces here, or at least an issue, is that, I mean, does he have instant, like, of the ways that he has to actually deal damage here by getting lands or whatever, like, Corey's not going to let him have his next draw step.
Right.
He's
I don't think
Kolaghan's
so,
Command his hand away from him and probably could do some damage, too. So, you know, Tribe Elder... And you can see it here. He's just sort of prepping him for it. But land like that,
right. You
know, I mean, there's a lot of cards that Kolaghan's Command gets. He's going to be safe and just get back the other Tassiger here and give himself some inevitability. In the meantime, bang, take four. He does not have a Creeping Tar Pit. Otherwise, he'd be attacking for lethal. He's going to drop Zach Voss down to three with this attack with Tassiger. And it is very difficult for Zach to win from here. He finds a way to get rid of Tassiger, which could buy him another turn, though. Still, Corey has Snapcaster Mage as an out, Lightning Bolt.
Yeah.
And he has, again, properly prepared for this scenario.
Well, Zach goes ahead and kills Tassiger, which is fine. But
oh,
he's got on board to the tar pit.
Yep. Dobbs. All right. That's going to do it for game one. Corey Burkhart disassembling the Titan Shift deck from the other undefeated player in this tournament. Corey Burkhart not to be stopped this weekend.
No, not so far. Maybe
you know,
not ever.
He played a lot of Grixis. Then he went away for it for one Modern GP. Was miserable with it being away from his good friend, this Grixis deck, and he's back on it, and boy, is it rewarding him.
I'm surprised more people have never run the tables completely to Grand Prix.
I am, too.
In history.
There's so many GPs.
There's one almost every weekend, and I think it's only happened once in history.
Do you mean from end to end, the full end to
end? Every match. X and O.
I actually don't know.
I'm pretty sure it's happened exactly
once. It's happened
one
either
time.
Zero or one time.
It's definitely happened once.
Okay. Do you know who did it?
I don't. Who do you think did it? It wasn't me. This is not a brag.
If I'm just guessing?
Yeah.
Kai?
No, it was John.
It was
close.
John.
Yeah.
I had to pick one of the other.
It was the first Grand Prix I ever played in. John ran the table.
Really?
I lost to him in like round 5. I thought it was so cool that I got to play against him.
Do you still think it's cool when you play against
him? Yeah, I do, actually. But yeah, he went, I guess at the time it was probably only like 16-0 total, including the top 8. He beat Randy in the finals. It was block constructed. Tempest block constructed.
Ooh.
Yeah, it was John was playing Survival Recurring Nightmare, and Randy was playing Counter Phoenix.
Those sound like sweet decks.
Yeah.
I don't
you
know
ever
what
see Counter
do?
Phoenix?
I don't even know
here's
what it
does. Here's how Magic was back then. Do you know what Shard Phoenix does?
I can picture the artwork.
So it's a 5-mana 2/2 flyer.
I know it comes back from somewhere.
Right. 5-mana 2/2 flyer. You could pay 3 red to return it from your graveyard to your hand in your upkeep, and it used Forbid, and it would just try to build up 9 mana to Forbid with buyback by discarding 2 Phoenixes, pay 6 red, return 2, and have Forbid up
and
again.
That's the lock?
That's the deck. Yeah.
That's
it
great.
It played like 30 land.
That's great. That's what Randy played?
Yeah.
That's sweet.
Yeah.
Now, what about the other side of the equation? By the way, you can take a look at Corey's undefeated Grixis deck.
We've seen this a couple
times. Much more important things here, yeah.
The other side was just Survival of the Fittest, one of the best Magic cards ever printed.
Yeah.
All kinds of utility creatures, Living Death, Recurring Nightmare, Scroll Rack.
Recurring Nightmare?
Yeah.
Man, Recurring Nightmare plus Survival of the Fittest is still great. Like, even, like, Cube, you can draft that combo.
You got to play really good cards. All the spikes, like Spike Weaver, Spike Feeder, Tradewind Rider, Rootwater Hunter was in the deck, Coffin Queen. You don't even know what half these cards do, I bet.
I know what Rootwater Hunter does. It's a pinger.
Yeah. Coffin Queen was like a 3-mana 1/1 where you could pay 3 and tap it to sort of like shallow grave a creature, like put a creature into play, it gains haste, exiled in a turn.
Okay.
Grave Diggers and all kinds of come into play creatures, and it was really fun.
Yeah, the closest that I think I saw to somebody running the tables at a GP was at GP Vancouver. No buys. Undefeated into the top 8. Jeremy did this. And he didn't end up winning, though. He lost, I think, in the semis.
Well, Luis almost did it at the Pro Tour.
Yeah, he did. And he ran the Swiss.
Right. Unfortunately, everybody would rather not run the Swiss than run the top 8.
Just run the top 8, yeah.
But even though it's a unique distinction. You know, I think he's still the only one to have run the Swiss, maybe.
Our friend Simon Gertsen.
He ran the Swiss, too?
No, he put an end to Luis's run at that
PT. Oh, yeah.
Simon with Jund.
Yund.
Yeah, the thing that Luis always talks about when he talks about that match, too, was that he had mulliganed a 5 in what would become the last game of that match, and there was a pause in the tournament for quite a while, and he had to just sit there and wait until he got blightened, and he knew it was coming, you know. And, you know, mulliganing against John was already miserable. And
I think exactly. Chat might be right. I think Ryan Fuller might have also run the Swiss in Japan in, like, the late 90s, early 2000s, but he also didn't win the tournament.
So early going here in game 2, Corey did 3 damage to himself, but got an Ancestral Vision in suspend mode on turn 1. And this is an important play here for Zach. Now, the thing about it is that it does shut off a lot of the cards from Corey. He has a lot of 1-mana spells in his deck.
Right.
The other side of the coin, though, is that Corey is running main deck Kolaghan's Command. And he can take care of a Chalice. It's not like the kind of card that's just a permanent that's going to stick around forever.
Right.
But it might slow him down. And it hasn't yet.
Right. Also, you see Zach just drew a second copy of Chalice. Chalice for 0, yeah. I was going to say, Chalice for 0 is pretty appealing here. That shuts off both these ancestral visions if Corey doesn't come up with an answer. I'm curious if Corey is going to cast this thought scour here. I think there's some merit to it because of Tasiger and just sort of like see what happens.
There's a chance that Zach forgets his trigger.
Right, exactly. That's what I meant by see what happens.
I know. I was explaining it because people are going to be yelling at you in the chat like, hey, if he casts it, it gets countered. Yeah. But that's what Huey's exploring here.
Well, the thing is, that's what I was going to say. The thing is, if he draws Colligan's command, it's unclear which of the chalice he even wants to kill.
Ah.
So, given that he has these two ancestral visions suspended, it seems to me like the chalice on zero is the one that's really causing you the problem anyway.
Yeah.
So,
because it'll find him more Colligan's commands or snapcasters or whatever
to
blow up the other one with.
So, although Corey does have a snapcaster in his hand, so.
Okay. Yeah, these matchups are really interesting because, this Titan Shift deck doesn't apply direct pressure to you very often. Like Corey has, right now he's got two visions up and there's no big chunks of damage coming over in the next turn or two. Uh-oh, man down. But when it does start dealing damage to you, it does it in massive,
huge, yeah.
Huge
groups.
See,
Zach this game has a copy of Through the Breach in his hand, which actually gives him an instant speed threat, something that normally, the Titan Shift deck can be lacking.
Well, I guess he found a threat.
Yeah, it's probably a case of
Reclamation Sage, just 2-1 go. That is not exciting.
Probably just a case of wanting it over some of the creature removal spells.
But Corey's going to respect it. He says, look, I don't have anything in my hand that's going to kill this for a while, so I'll just take my 2-for-1 here. He could have made him discard a card instead, but the onboard play was better. And by the way, he did go with your play, Huey, of just blowing up the chalice on zero.
Yeah, I think it's pretty clear in this case. You really want to make sure that those ancestral visions are getting off.
Which, tick-tock, next turn, 4 cards, turn after that, 4 cards.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think it might have been better for Corey to wait one turn, because if Zach had another chalice here, another chalice for zero would be a real problem right now. Corey wouldn't be able to answer it before the vision, and if Corey had just waited until the end of this turn, he would have been able to make sure that the first ancestral vision at least resolved, no matter what. Zach casts a Pulse of Murasa to return the wooded foothills.
Corey thought about it for a while and then said, okay, yeah, sure.
Yeah, I think he was just posturing, though.
Yeah.
Which is totally fine. Yeah, you don't want to give away, I'm F6, go ahead.
Right.
I have nothing, but...
Because he could have a cryptic command there.
He could, yeah, or he could have a remand. I mean, we know he doesn't have a remand, but from Zach's perspective, he could have a remand.
Totally. All right, and here it is, the first big payoff, Ancestral Vision, 1, 2, 3, and then another one for the draw step, and bang, there's that cryptic command, which is, ooh, there's another 1, 2.
It's true, but 2 of those 3 cards cost 1 against the chalice.
The thing, that Corey's going to be able to play around here, though, is just by passing the turn repeatedly, he's going to make it very difficult for Zach to fire off, anything here, as it looks like Zach may be missing a land drop. But you mentioned the Through the Breach, and that is a way that Zach can interact with Corey.
It lets him stack threats. It's really hard to... What I mean by that is cast multiple things that Corey needs to counter with only one untap from Corey, which, the big mana green decks don't do that well because most of their stuff is done main phase.
The things get really interesting here because Corey has also brought in Surgical Extraction.
Right.
Which can make life very difficult for Zach if he gets his Primeval Titans surgically extracted. Like maybe one of them goes on the stack and Corey says, nah, I'm going to counter it. And
right.
Then... boom, he can take away the rest.
Yeah, he almost,
ooh,
it's very, very challenging to win.
Yeah, Corey
without the Primeval Titans.
Look at his hand. All right, he's just going to Surgical right now. And take out the Through the Breach. Now, he may also just be setting up for a Snapcaster Mage on the Surgical Extraction. This one lets him know what's in hand for Zach. And he also gets a chance to just thumb through the library to see how Zach has sideboarded here for game 2 in case there's anything
he needs
to know.
In my opinion, when You force somebody to discard a card and they discard it through the breach, it means one of two things. It means they have another through the breach, or they don't have any other threats.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, if Zach has no Titans, he's probably not going to discard through the breach unless he has more. And if he doesn't have Titans, then whatever.
Yep.
You're so far ahead. So I think Corey knowing that either it's a through the breach heavy hand, in which case it's with through the breach and Titans, you certainly want to get rid of the through the breach so Zach can't stack threats, like I said. And I think a good play to just go ahead and surgical the through the breach there.
Yeah, and now he has a surgical in his graveyard and hard counters in his hand, and he knows what he's up against here. So, again, if Zach goes for a Primeval Titan, Corey can simply counter it, surgical the other one away along with the rest of them in the deck. Now, there's that land that Zach probably thought he wanted to see here. This is not going to end well.
No. So he's going to cast Primeval Titan. Corey can just cryptic counter it, bounce Snapcaster Mage, snap surgical the Titan, and that's it.
And he can do it right now, too. Yeah. All of that right now. So here we go. Cryptic Command. Counter that. Return Snapcaster Mage to my hand. And then on your end step, play Snapcaster Mage. Now he's thinking about life totals here, but you know, if he wants, he can just get this thing down, get rid of all your Primeval Titans, including the other one in his hand. This is disgusting.
I mean, the game is not literally over. I mean, you know, what I mean is the game is over, but Zach's deck is capable of winning with just put a Valakut into play, play some mountains. But he's just too far behind. He doesn't have enough time or any cards, any resources. He also has a forest in play, which I guess doesn't matter at this point. But
now the interesting thing that we're seeing here, though, is that Corey does need to now apply pressure, right? He does need to, like, he can't stop land drops.
No, but, you know, I mean, well, that was a good draw. He does have the Snapcaster Mage, a bunch of counters. Now he has Tasigur.
Yeah, the thing is, like, the times when Zach wins this is when Corey has no pressure. His hand is all reactive stuff, and Corey goes, draw a card, Valakut, go.
Zach, but yeah.
Zach does, right. And then, you know, just starts playing mountains and, like, take three, you know. It's just so much resources available for Corey Burkhardt
at
this point.
So slow. I mean, that's
yes.
A turn to draw Valakut, a turn to draw another Valakut or mountain, and then two more turns of drawing lands. That's four turns of perfect draws.
Hey, look.
Well, there's one, but that's not even good enough now.
Yeah, and the Tasigur certainly is the pressure that Corey needed. So, Corey's got to feel very confident, and coming in will be 12-0 to start the GP off.
Also, Corey can just go ahead and cryptic that Valakut if he wants. And it basically slows Zach by an entire turn.
It does. He can't play two lands a turn. He's got to have both of them to make the damage start flowing.
So he got surgical. Now,
does he just take one of these lands?
No. In my opinion, Corey can just wait. And if he draws Kolaghan's Command, he can... Well, he's going to cast it.
Yeah, I know where you were going.
Yeah, I was
going
to say, cryptic to bounce the Valakut, Kolaghan's Command to discard it, surgical it, game's over, you're locked out.
Game is effectively completely over at that point. Corey's going to be a little bit more aggressive with it and take away his wooded foothills. This is largely academic, but I really like your... That's a intricate but game-ending line that you came up with.
Yeah, I mean, it's whatever. It's a bit... you know, it's not a short thing. He has to still find a Kolaghan's Command, which he doesn't have.
Sure.
But I don't think...
Milieu.
I don't think the slight value of surgicaling the Wooded Foothills is necessarily worth it.
No, though. Corey's literally has seven spells in his hand at the moment, and he's attacking for six. Snapcaster Mage goes back on top of the library. And you can see that Corey's playing quickly at this point. He knows that he's, you know, high 90s% to win this game. Corey Burkhardt just double-checking Valakut the Molten Pinnacle. Draw step, and it's a mountain. And that does mean that the Snapcaster Mage is under fire here. So it looks like he's going to extend the hand. All right, so that's going to do it. Corey Burkhart, 12-0 to start things off here at GP Dallas Fort Worth with his Grixis value deck. And, man, he has been playing that thing like a flute. Looks perfect every time we see him play. It's beautiful. He's played a lot of this deck. He's put a lot of work in on it, and it sure is paying off for him here, as that top eight is really in sight for him. Now,
I was talking to Corey yesterday in between rounds. He just loves the deck.
He loves this deck.